Okay, so we're beginning the Haggadah of Passover, right? The Haggadah is one of the oldest books in our library. It was written by the Anshei Knesset HaGadolah, the men of the Great Assembly, approximately 400 years before the Mishnah was written down. The oldest books of our library, right? It was written at the time when the temple was still standing, when we still had the Passover sacrifice, and after the destruction, a number of changes were made. So before we begin the Haggadah, we have to talk about a number of important themes of Passover. First one is freedom, right? What does freedom mean? Sometimes I think the secular concept of freedom is not much different than that of the animals in the zoo. If you ask the animals in the zoo, what would be your greatest desire? What would they say? Open up the bars, let me be a wild animal, right? Born free, right? That's not the Jewish concept, right? And just for an example, the first Passover in Egypt, right? I mean, for weeks and weeks before the holiday began, the fathers had to study in the kollel. They had to study all day long. The laws of slaughtering animals, laws of slaughtering sacrifices, the laws of baking matzah, right? And they had to circumcise all their sons. They had many sons, right? Then finally the time comes, they have to have their belt on and their staff in their hand and their shoes on, right? Like you're about to go on a trip. You have to have your passport ready and your suitcase packed, right? Ready to go. And then it says you have to eat it b'chipazon, in a rush. Right. Is that your picture of freedom? All right? He's following instructions, right? A modern Passover Seder, the father sits at the head of the table. It says in the Haggadah, now we pour the wine. Okay, now we pour the wine. Now it says, break the matzah, right? And the wife says, my father did it this way. Okay, do it this way. And the kid says, my teacher said, do it that way. I think the reason why the Passover Seder makes such an impression on the children is usually the father's bossing everybody around, and now he's following instructions. But the concept is free from the yoke of man to do the will of God. When you're a slave, you can't keep Shabbos, you can't keep the Torah, right? We want freedom for one purpose, to be the servants of the Almighty. Free from the service, not slaves, no more slaves of Pharaoh, servants of the Almighty. That's the concept of freedom. Now, the Passover night is the climax of the Jewish year, the highlight of the Jewish year, right? The vast majority of Jews in the world have some sort of a Passover Seder, right? When the tradition is given over from father to son, story of a girl on a kibbutz. You know, the secular Israelis love Passover. That's, you know, some holidays are popular, some are less popular. You know? Tisha B'Av is not popular at all, right? Purim is a lot of fun, right? But Passover, freedom, right? What am I free to do, right? She didn't know what she's free to do, so she traveled around the world to look for freedom, right? Till she ended up becoming religious. Her grandfather's 90 years old, he's still an atheist, right? He hasn't forgiven her yet, right? What does freedom mean? Now, in the secular world, we have a concept called we want to commemorate an event that happened in the past. In America, we have Washington's birthday and Lincoln's birthday, Independence Day. If it doesn't happen to come out on a convenient day of the week, you push it off to Monday, so you have a nice long weekend, right? But we don't commemorate events in the past. The concept is to relive them. Right? It says in Haggadah, a person has to see themselves as if they personally left Egypt. Some Sephardic Jews have a beautiful custom. Right in the middle of the Passover, say there's a knock on the door. The guy comes hanging, carrying a sack behind his back. Where are you coming from? I'm coming from Mitzrayim, Egypt. Where are you going? Yerushalayim, Israel, right? They take the matzahs, put it on their shoulders, they march around the table, they put on a whole skit to make it come alive. We don't just talk about the bitterness in Egypt. You burn your mouth on some horseradish, right? We don't talk about traveling in the desert. You go out of your house for a week and sit in the sukkah. We stay up all night on Shavuos. The idea is to relive it, because every year when that time comes, the special effects that come from heaven at that time come again, and every person can relate to them. That's the idea. So we have to relate, we have to see ourselves as if we personally went out of Egypt. Now, the word Seder means order. It's written with a structure. So before the Haggadah was written down, every father would tell his children the story in his own words. Just like before the Seder was written down, everybody would pray in his own words. But people were not capable of doing that anymore. So the rabbis gave us the structure of the Passover Seder, right? And it's interesting, the night of the Seder, we have four mitzvahs, basically, that we're doing. Two mitzvahs of the Torah, and two mitzvahs of the rabbis, right? And surrounding these four mitzvahs, we have the whole order of the Seder. From the Torah, we're required to eat matzah. It says from the Torah, eat matzah on Passover night. And to tell the story of the going out of Egypt. Those are the two Torah laws. It says from the Torah, eat morer, bitter herb, but only when you have a Passover sacrifice. You shall eat the Passover sacrifice on matzah and morer. But since today we don't have a Passover sacrifice, we're not required from the Torah to eat Passover and morer, but the rabbis commanded us to eat morer in spite of that. Anyway, and the fourth one is the four cups of wine, because there are four expressions of redemption in the Torah. In the book of Exodus, Parshas Va'era, God says, I will take you out from under the burdens of Egypt. This is Exodus chapter 6, verse 6. I will rescue them. I will rescue them from the service. I'll redeem you with an outstretched arm, a great judgment. I will take you to me for a people. That's four. We have four cups of wine, four sons, four questions. It's actually a fifth one. Next verse says, I will bring you into the land. That corresponds to the fifth cup, the cup of Elijah that we don't drink. That's hinting to the Messiah comes, the Mashiach comes, right? So corresponding to these four expressions of redemption, we have four cups of wine. So you could drink them one after another, right? That's what I do on Purim, right? But on Pesach, we don't want to get drunk. We divide them up, right? The first one is Kiddush. The second one is after the Maggid telling the story, Gal Yisrael, we have Bracha, Gal Yisrael. The third is by the Halal. The fourth is the grace of the meals, and then the Halal. So surrounding these four mitzvahs, the rabbis made the format of the Seder with the leaning, with the karpas, with the dipping in the salt water, washing your hands, breaking the matzah, afikoman, the exact text of the Haggadah, the blessings, Gal Yisrael, blessings on the matzah, on the maror, the charoses, right? And we're missing one thing, we're missing the Passover sacrifice that we don't have, right? We have we put a shank bone on the table, we put a roasted neck and wing of a chicken, which we don't eat. We just put it on as a reminder. In fact, the custom is not to eat any roasted meat at the Seder. Don't want you to make a mistake of thinking we have a Passover sacrifice today. You know, we say, L'shana haba b'Yushalayim, next year in Jerusalem, only twice a year. We say it at the end of the Yom Kippur service when they blow the shofar at the end of Yom Kippur, and we say it at the end of the Passover Seder. And what's the common denominator between these two holidays? All the other holidays of the year, if we can have it without a temple. We can have a shofar, we can have a sukkah, we can have a lulav, right? But these two holidays, we're missing the main point. The main point of Yom Kippur was the high priest going into the Holy of Holies. We don't have that, we're missing it. Next year in Jerusalem. And the main point of the Passover Seder was the Passover sacrifice. We're missing that next year in Jerusalem. You see the theme, Yivne Beis HaMikdash, build the Beis HaMikdash so we can bring the Passover sacrifice. That's what's missing tonight. All right. Now, the Haggadah begins with a list of the order, and Kadesh Yorkas, it's on page 19, right? And it's customary to sing. I'll sing it to you first. Kadesh Urchatz Karpas Yachatz Magid Rochtzo Motzi Matzo Moror Korech Shulchon Orech Tzofun Borech Halel Nirtzo. This is the order of the Seder. Now, we'll go through, just explain each one. Kadesh is the Kiddush, which you make every holiday. Urchas, we wash our hands without making a bracha. Karpas, we dip a vegetable in the salt water. It can be any vegetable that that you make the brei pri adama, except for what we use for the bitter herbs, the horseradish or the romaine lettuce. Yachas, we break the matzah in half. Magid, we tell the story of the going out of Egypt. Rochtzo, we wash for bread. Motzi, we make the bracha, motzi lechem in aretz. Matzah, we make the bracha to eat the matzah. Moro, we eat the bracha, make the bracha and eat the moro, the bitter herbs. Korach, we have the sandwich, we put the matzah and moro together. Shulchan Aruch is, we set table, we eat the meal. Sofon is, we take out the afikoma that was hidden away. Borech is the grace after meals. Halal is the praise to God. And Nirtza is the final part where we ask HaKashab to accept our Passover Seder with the songs and the spirit already is ready for the Mashiach to come. Okay, let me go through it a little bit more in detail, elaborate a little bit more. Kaddish is the Kiddush, right? Every Shabbat and every holiday, we start off with a sanctification on the wine. I call it the national anthem. You know, before you play ball, you have the national anthem. We're proclaiming this day special. That's every holiday. And on Passover, that's the first of the four cups. So everybody has usually the master of ceremony, the father makes Kiddush, and he's mostly over here, but everybody has a cup of wine in front of them, and they drink their own cup of wine. Karpas, Urchas Karpas. So why do we make a bracha on the vegetable in the beginning of the meal? First of all, we want to do something different to arouse the curiosity of the children. We want the children to ask questions. So we do things which are different than normally. Usually after we make kiddush, we wash and eat bread, and now we're eating some vegetable. Why are you doing that? Right? There's really a halachic reason why we do that. You see, when you make hamotzi, that bracha hamotzi takes care of all the food you eat during the meal. You don't have to make any other blessings, except for something which is not actually part of the meal. For example, if you eat fruit for dessert, you have to make a brei pri eitz. If you drink wine during the meal, if you didn't make kiddush in the beginning, you have to make a brei pri agafen, right? Something which is not part of the meal. So the question is, we're going to eat the bitter herbs, the moror. Is the moror part of the meal? If it would not be a mitzvah to eat moror, would you eat moror? Probably not, right? It's a question. Do you have to make a bracha on it or not? In order to alleviate that problem, we take some other vegetable, that's Brei Pri Adama, we make the blessing in the beginning of the meal, and we have in mind that that should be for the Morah. But you have to, there's one catch. You can't eat too much. You have to eat a little piece, because if you eat more than a kazayit, then you have to make an after blessing, right? Then you got a problem with the Morah again, right? And it's a problem because you're very hungry at the night of the Seder. You know why? There's a reason why you're very hungry at the night of the Seder. Because we can't eat bread on Erev Pesach, except in the morning, right? You get up early, this year comes out on Shabbos, a Friday morning after about 9, 10 o'clock, and you have to see the calendar, you can't eat bread anymore, right? And it's a custom not to eat matzah 2 weeks before Passover, not to eat matzah, have a good appetite for matzah, right? So what do you eat Erev Pesach? No bread, no matzah, right? So eat some potatoes, eat some chicken, eat whatever, but you're usually hungry, right? They give you a nice piece of potato, dipped in salt water, it's so delicious, can I have another piece? No, it's small piece, here's karpas, right? All right. Now, there's a law, the idea of washing our hands before bread is based on the rabbinical decree for the Kohanim ate the truma, the special foods, and it was usually grain. And there's a law, we have laws of spiritual contamination, tamei. Now, from the Torah law, either you're tamei or you're not tamei, right? It's all halfway, right? But the rabbis made a decree, since the hands are always touching things, that there's such a thing called the tumas yadayim. The hands are tamei, and before a Kohen can eat the truma, he's got to wash his hands 2 times to take off the tumah. And that's and so today we don't have the truma, so we every time we eat bread, we wash our hands. We make a bracha. This law also applies to any fruit or vegetable that's wet. If you eat a fruit or vegetable that's wet, you're supposed to wash your hands without a bracha beforehand. For some reason, most people don't keep this law. I don't know why, but it's in the books. You're supposed to do it, right? I know people that do, right? But anyway, but the night of Seder, everybody does it. Because you want to do something different to arouse the curiosity. So we want to dip the salt water represents the tears. You want to dip the vegetable in the salt water. So first, you wash your hands without a bracha. That's orchatz and that's karpas. Now we break the matzah. What's the idea of breaking the matzah? The matzah is called lechem oni, poor man's bread. Does a poor man generally have a whole loaf or a piece? Tell me. Piece. A poor man begs for bread. No, most people don't give him a whole loaf, they give him a piece. So he has a piece. So in order for the matzah to symbolize poor man's bread, it should be a broken piece. But we know we have a law called Lechem Mishnah. Whenever you have a Shabbos meal or a Yantav meal, you have to have 2 whole challahs or 2 whole matzahs, right? So how do you have your cake and eat it? How can you have a broken piece and whole thing at the same time? The answer is, take 3 matzahs, right? And break one. So now you have 2 whole ones, that's a motzi, and then you have the broken pieces, the bracha al yechidas matzah, right? Now you have, what do you do with the other piece, right? So the custom is to hide it away till the end of the meal. See, the matzah represents today, since we don't have a Passover sacrifice, this matzah, this extra piece of matzah, has to be instead of that Passover sacrifice. And the Passover sacrifice was eaten a little bit, a kazayis was eaten in the beginning of the meal, and the rest was eaten at the end. You're supposed to eat the Passover sacrifice when you're full. Not totally stuffed, but not hungry, because you can't break any bones, you have to eat it with respect. So the main course at the Passover sacrifice, Seder, when they had the temple times, was the chagigah. Chagigah was the holiday sacrifice. Usually it was meat, and that was eaten as the main course, and after that, the dessert was the Passover sacrifice. So we take that piece of matzah, and we hide it away for the end. That's going to be the afikoman. That's going to be eaten in the end. That's going to be instead of the Passover sacrifice. So a custom evolved among the Jews. We want to keep the children's interest. They shouldn't fall asleep in the middle, right? So the father hides it away, and the children have to find it, and then the children hide it away, and the father has to find it, right? And then he's got to negotiate to get it back. What's he going to buy for them, right? This is not the main point of the Seder, as some people think, right? But it is. That is just a custom, which is a very beautiful custom. The point of it is to keep the children's interest. They shouldn't fall asleep in the middle, right? That's the idea. So we hide away. By the way, by the time the children bring it back, it's usually in crumbs, right? You got to take another piece of matzah. You have to come in. It's not just that piece. You have to add more. You have to eat a big piece of matzah of afikoman. So you have to add on matzah to do it anyway. That's yachatz. Now we come to the Maggid and we tell the story of the going out of Egypt, right? And we try to make it as fast as possible because it's recommended to eat the afikoman before half the night, which is like 11:30, 11:45, depending on how many hours a night is, right? If you miss it, you miss it, right? But it's preferably the chatchila, you should try to eat the afikoman before half the night. So we try to keep the Torah, everybody wants to say something on the Haggadah, right? Try to keep it as short as possible in order that we should reach the afikoman before the chatzos if possible. Then we finish the Maggid, right? Then roch. So we wash our hands as we normally wash our bread. Motzi, we make a bracha. Motzi lechem in ours on the 2 whole ones. Matzah, we make the bracha lechilas matzah. And you've got to eat a big piece of matzah. I mean, a kazayis. We say an olive, right? See, the question is, what is called eating? What's the definition of eating? Normally, right? I take a crumb, I eat a crumb, I wait an hour, eat another crumb, another hour, neither. Is that eating normally? Obviously not, right? how about 2 crumbs in a half an hour? Would you believe 3 crumbs in 15 minutes, right? So where do you draw the line, right? So Rabbi said the minimum it's called eating is the size of an olive and the time it takes to eat a slice of bread. Mekazayis achilas pras. Size of olive doesn't mean take a little olive, put it on a piece of bread and cut around. That's not what it means. It means volume, mass, as in water displacement. Another thing is we have a tradition that the olives in the olden days were much larger than today. An olive is approximately the size of half a chicken egg. Right? So you take a full glass of water, you put in it an olive the size of half a chicken egg, and see how much water it displaces. Then you take bread, roll it into a ball, and see how much get all the air out, how much bread to displace the same amount of water. It's approximately a slice of bread, right? Matzah, the minimum amount of a kazayis would be half of a round matzah, 2/3 of a square. There are more stricter opinions, but that would be the minimum. A half of a round matzah, 2/3 of a square matzah, right? And how much time is the time it takes to eat a slice of bread? There's different opinions ranging from 2 minutes to 9 minutes. So preferably you should eat a large piece of matzah within 2 minutes. If that's difficult, 3 minutes, 4 minutes, up to 9. If it takes more than 9, you gotta do it again, right? The converse would be safe on Yom Kippur if somebody's very ill. And they have to eat, so if they're very ill, they can eat normally, but someone is ill, they've gotta eat, but they can eat a little at a time. Preferably they should eat a piece of bread less than the size of an olive, wait 9 minutes, and eat another piece less than that, that way they're not technically eating. Because if you're not ill, you're not allowed to do it anyway. I'm keeping getting it anyway, even without that. But that's matzah. Then and a man has to eat it leaning on his left side. Women are not required to. Men have to leaning on their left, leaning on something, not just in the air, leaning on something, on someone. You can lean on your friend if you want, right? But leaning on something on your left side, only on your left. Even if you're a lefty and it's hard to eat with your right hand, on your left side, because it's leaning on your right side is dangerous. There's a covering over the food pipe and the air pipe that opens up when you lean on your right side, so you can choke. So it's dangerous, only on your left side, not on your right side. Then comes the morer, the bitter herbs. This is not leaning, right? But you have to have a large amount. So it can either be horseradish, which should be ground right before Passover, it should be strong, it shouldn't be very, very weak, right? Or romaine lettuce. Romaine lettuce is problematic because it has a lot of bugs on it. There are these transparent bugs that you can't see very well. And even after you rinse it off, they stick. When I was a kid, we used to spend hours. We never ate romaine lettuce except at the Passover Seder because it's hard to eat so much horseradish, right? So we would soak it in either in salt water or in Passover vinegar, right? And then they would let the grips go. Then we take every leaf, put it up to light, knock off all the bugs. They're transparent. You have to look very closely. Then we would check a second time. We'd always find a second time as well. Today, thanks to modern technology, it's easier. There's a company called Bodeg that electronically cleans it. Israel, we have these Gush Katif. They have these special greenhouses where they grow without the bugs, right? But so if you only eat horseradish, you have to eat a large amount, like a whiskey glass full of horseradish. If you only eat romaine lettuce, you have to eat a lot of leaves. So many people put them together. If you combine horseradish and leaves, then you have to eat less. And we dip it into the charoses. What's the charoses? Charoses is a mixture made of apples and nuts in wine. It tastes delicious, right? But it looks like mortar, the mortar that they made with the bricks. It reminds us of the mortar. And in order to take away the sharpness of the mortar, we dip the mortar into the charoses. You don't put a lot of charoses, just dip it in, right? Right? Then shake it off, right? A little bit, right? And that's the dipping, right? So we had two dippings. We had the dipping of the karpas into the salt water and the morer into the charoses, right? And you eat a big piece of morer, you make a bracha alechilas morer. Then comes the korach. The korach is a sandwich. Does anybody know why we call a sandwich a sandwich? Where did the name sandwich come from? The Earl of Sandwich supposedly was the first person to have the idea of taking two pieces of bread and putting something in the middle, right? But it's really a misnomer. It really should be called a Hillel, right? Because Hillel lived many years before the Earl of Sandwich, right? And it says in the Torah, you shall eat the Passover sacrifice, al matzos morim yichlu, on matzah and morim you shall eat it. So the rabbis say it means take a piece of matzah, take a piece of morim, take a piece of Passover sacrifice, right? But Hillel said we take them together, take two pieces of matzah, put it in between the morim and eat them all together. He had the first sandwich, right? How do you say sandwich in modern Hebrew? Sandwich, that's slang, but the real thing is it's korach, kricha, comes from korach, all right. All right, so we don't really follow Hillel's opinion. We follow the rabbi's opinion, because first we eat the matzah separately, and then we eat the morah separately, right? But then after eating the matzah and morah, we also want to follow Hillel's opinion. So we don't make a bracha. We already made the brachas. We just say, so did Hillel do when the temple was standing, ate them both together, and we eat a piece of matzah and morah together, also a big piece of matzah, a piece of morah, and we eat it together leaning. That's the korach. All right, by the time you finish with that, you're full already, right? Then comes the Shulchan Aruch, the meal. Then comes the chicken and the fish and the soup, right? And what do you talk about during the meal? You know, you just spent 2 hours during the Maggid telling about the going out of Egypt, all the details. Now you talk about the weather, talk about the news. No, you talk about the going out of Egypt. It's not just during the Maggid. You have got a whole Maggid. You're supposed to talk about the going out of Egypt. Even during the meal, talk about it. So I tell my children, you know, when everybody wants to say something on the Haggadah, the short things say during the Maggid, and the long things during the meal when everybody's eating. Then you can say the long things, right? But during the meal, you should also talk about the going out of Egypt. Then comes the tzafun. We come to the end of the meal, and we look for the afikoman. It's missing, and the children have to find it, right? And they have to negotiate, what are you going to buy me, right? Finally, you get it back, it's some crumbs, you got to add more to it, and everybody got a big piece of matzah. Again, half of a round matzah, two-thirds of a square matzah, and you have to eat it leading. That's the car, without a bracha, you're at the end of the meal. And so if you want to eat fruit for dessert, you can eat it before, right? But after the afikoman, we can't eat at all. Why can't we eat after the afikoman? Because what was the last course of the Passover said in temple times? The Passover sacrifice. You couldn't eat after that. Why couldn't you eat after that? Right. So I think the reason is, you know, after the Seder's over, you know, most people after 4 cups of wine go to sleep, right? But if you don't go to sleep after the Seder, you want to take a walk with your children, you're still up, what do you talk about after the Seder's over? The news? The weather? No, you talk about the going out of Egypt all night long, right? But you might forget. As a reminder, you know, I have this strange taste in my mouth. Usually after a meal, I have a sweet taste. How come I have this matzah taste? How come I have this oily taste? Oh yeah, we just said the Korban Pesach. We just said the matzah, right? To remind you to continue talking about the going out of Egypt even after the Seder is over. The last course is either the Passover sacrifice or the Afikoman. And then comes Barek, the grace after meals, and we make the bracha on the wine. And then comes the Hallel. Actually, the Hallel is divided up. We actually say 2 paragraphs of the Hallel before the meal and the rest after the meal, right? And we don't make a bracha. Because it's divided up, we don't make the bracha on the Hallel. There are communities that have a custom, I think Sfaradim and Hasidim have a custom that, I think Yekis also have this, German Jews also have this custom, that in Shul, after Maariv, since we don't say Hallel with the bracha, they have the Seder, they say Hallel with the bracha after Maariv, right? Many people have that custom, right? Right? It's the only time we say Hallel at night. You usually only say Hallel during the daytime, right? But at the Seder, we save 2 paragraphs before and the rest after, and the middle is the meal. And someone said the reason for that is because the way you eat your meal on the Seder night has to be a praise to God. That's also Hallel. That's part of the Hallel. We start the Hallel before, we end the Hallel in the end, and the middle is the meal. The way you eat your meal, that has to be a praise to God as well. And finally, we come to the songs and the end of the Seder. Chad Gadya, Echad Meyodeya, right? If we come have time in the end, I'll sing it to you, right? And Yivna Beisel Bekarv. The theme is we're ready now for the final redemption. Yivna Beisel, build his house. You know, by German Jews, they have a German version of it. Boyenzi, they should build his house, right? And it's such an integral part of their Seder that the custom in Germany was that they would wish each other good yontif. After Shul, they would say, Boyenzi, good. You should reach to Boyenzi. You get to the song of Boyenzi, build Yivna Beisel, good, right? Okay, so now we start the actual Haggadah, right? And we start with the Maggid. So on page 25, you have Halach Ma'anya, right? So this is an Aramaic, interesting saying. Before we say, we already made Kiddush, right? We already broke the matzah, we put away the afikoman, we had the karpas, and we say, Halach Ma'anya di'achal avasana ba'ar d'mitzrayim. This is in Aramaic. This is the poor bread that our ancestors ate in the land of Egypt. There's another version that says, Ke Halach Ma'anya. This is like the poor bread. What's the difference between these two? It's on page 25. What's the difference between these two versions? We'll see in a minute, right? Whoever's hungry, come and eat. Whoever's needy, come and eat the Passover sacrifice with us. Yifsach means eat the Passover sacrifice with us. Now we are here, next year let us be in the land of Israel. Now we are slaves, next year let us be free. This whole paragraph makes absolutely no sense. Absolutely no sense, right? First of all, why is it in Aramaic? The whole Haggadah is in Hebrew, except for this paragraph and one song in the end. Which one? What's the last song in the Haggadah? Chad Gadya. It's also in Aramaic, right? Obviously, these were added later. When? When we spoke Aramaic. When was that? When we went to Babylon. Babylon, the language was Aramaic, right? So when we exiled to Babylon, we say we added this. This was added on. This is the poor bread that our ancestors ate in the land of Egypt. Whoever's hungry, come and eat. Does that make any sense? The father comes home from shul, closes the door, makes Kiddush. He says, any guests want to join us? If you wanted to invite guests, you should have invited them before. Why are you inviting them now? It's a little bit late to invite guests. Don't you think so, right? Whoever's hungry, come and eat. Whoever's needy, come and at Yifsak, eat the Passover sacrifice. 1 second. I mean, can you invite guests to your Passover sacrifice? No, right? The Passover sacrifice, the lamb had to be finished. It had to be eaten totally. So before you sacrificed it, you always slaughtered it. You have to know how many people are there. Are there enough people in your family to eat an entire lamb. If not, so two families have to get together, or three families, right? Before you slaughter the lamb, you know exactly who's going to eat it. So you can't invite people to your Passover. And is this paragraph talking in temple times? It says, Yifsach. A minute later, it says, now we're here. Next year, we're in the land of Israel. Now we're slaves. Next year, Israel, implying they were slaves. They were not in Israel, right? Are you in Israel? You're not in Israel. Which one? So Chassam Sofer has an interesting explanation. He says, this was Kol Dichinese V'Yichel doesn't mean people outside. Whoever's hungry, the father is talking to the people at the Seder. If you're hungry, eat. It means eat the Chagiga. Remember, the Passover sacrifice was eaten at the end when you were full. So if you're hungry, you can't eat the Passover sacrifice, right? First eat, come and eat the Chagiga, the first, the main course, right? And then if Nitzrich, if you need to fulfill the mitzvah, now eat the Passover sacrifice. That was what every year the father would say. First, whoever's hungry, eat the Chagiga. Whoever's needy, afterwards, eat the Passover sacrifice. That we said every year. So imagine the first year after the destruction of the temple. And the Jews are in Babylon, right? On the Tigris, on the Euphrates, right? And they're reminiscing. That's why it's in Aramaic. This is the poor bread of our ancestors in Egypt. Last year we said, whoever's hungry, come and eat. Whoever's needy, the Passover sacrifice. Remember last year we had a Passover sacrifice? But now we're here. Next year let us be in the land of Israel. Now we're slaves. Next year let us be free. But why is it halach ma'anya and ke halach ma'anya? What's the difference between this is the poor bread, this is like the poor bread? So the market gives a beautiful analogy. That's an analogy of a man who was very poor. And he had rags, his clothes were in rags. And he ate hard bread, that was his meals. One day, he made a little bit of money and invested it. And he made a little more money and invested it. Little by little, right? He finally, you're taping this? You're taping it? Eventually, he became a rich man. But he didn't want to forget he was once poor. You know, nouveau rich, he wanted to remember he was once poor. So every year on the day when he made his money, he would put on his old rags, it takes a piece of hard bread, right? And then he'd make a big party for his children to give everybody presents. And the children look forward to that day. When they saw him in his rags, it's that day, right? But then he lost a little bit of money. He lost a little bit more money, a little bit more money, till eventually he became poor again. What did he do? Put on his old rags, took a piece of hard bread. His children thought that, oh, it's that day again. I'm sorry, children, it's not that day again. Now we're really poor. What's the analogy? We were slaves in Egypt, and we had poor bread, we ate matzah, we were slaves, and then God freed us. And now we're in the land of Israel, and everybody has his field and his vineyard, but we say, Kil Lachmanya, this is like the poor, we're going to remember the past, this is like the poor bread we ate in Egypt, right? But now the temple was destroyed, and we're in exile again. It's not Kil Lachmanya, it's Hol Lachmanya. This is the poor bread. Now we're in the same boat again, now we're slaves again, right? Now this year we're here, next year let us be in the land of Israel. And now, we take the Seder plate, and we put it on the other end of the table. And she'll say, why'd you do that? That's why we wanted you to ask, right? We wanted you to ask questions, right? And now comes the four questions. The four questions, right? When I was teaching Hebrew school, you know, the kids in Hebrew school in America, the only thing they knew was barely how to read Hebrew, some Bible stories, and the four questions. So they come to the Passover Seder, ask four questions to go to sleep. Four questions, no answers, right? Till your bar mitzvah, main thing being the bar, forget about the mitzvah, have the bar, have the party, and that's the end of the Jewish education, right? The four questions, right? Why is this night different than all of the nights? I'm sure you heard the bad joke about the Queen of England. She's knighting this knight, and he kneels in front of her, right? And he puts the sword on his shoulders, and she puts the sword on his shoulder, and he's supposed to say this formula in Latin. But, you know, he was a Jew. He forgot the formula. He figured she wouldn't know the difference. Instead, he said, Manishtano, Alayla, Zemi, Kyle. She said, why is this night different than all other nights, right? And all of the nights, we eat bread and matzah. This night, we only eat matzah. And all of the nights, we eat all kinds of vegetables. This night, bitter vegetables. And all of the nights, we don't dip even once. This night, we dip twice. The matzah, we said the karpas and the salt water and the mortar and the charoses. All the nights, we sitting and leaning. This night, only leaning. In temple times, leaning was common. So it wasn't something to ask a question. Instead, they had a different question. They said, all of the nights, we eat all kinds of meat. This night, only roasted meat. That was a question they asked in temple times. Okay, I'm sure you people have been to many Passover Seders in your lifetime. It's a good thing you came to this class, because you're finally going to find out, after all these years, what's the answer to the four questions? What's the answer to the four questions? Right. We were slaves to Pharaoh, and he has to answer the question, right? So I have to start over a little bit of background, right? The Midrash, says that, you know, Pharaoh, right, was a very, very wicked person, right? The Torah says it was the middle of the night and Pharaoh got up and there was an outcry in all of Egypt, right? Where did he get up from? Where did he get up from the middle of the night? Tell me.
bed.
From your bed, right? So Rashi, the classic commentary, says he got up from his bed. What's Rashi coming to teach us? Obviously, he got up from his bed. Where else did he get up from the middle of the night? I think Rashi is telling us something very profound. You see, imagine if a fortune teller with a track record of 9 out of 9 tells you you're going to die at midnight. Right, yeah. You don't believe him, right? What do you think you would do? You think you'd go to sleep or stay up at midnight just in case, right? Out of curiosity, right? You don't want to die in your sleep, right? Don't you think you'd stay up? No, you stay up. We're going to sleep, right? Moshe predicted 9 plagues, and they all came true. And it's at midnight, all the first one. Now, if you saw the movie, The Ten Commandments, right? If you like the movie, you love the book, right? This is the book, right? This is the book, right? But anyway, you like the book, you love the movie, right? So, but it's a little bit different in the book than the movie, right? Pharaoh, right? Brushed his teeth, put in his pajamas. Moshe predicted nine plagues. They all came true. He says, the firstborn, Pharaoh was the firstborn. Forget about the movie. The movie focused on his son. Pharaoh himself was the firstborn, said the rabbis. Right? And he said, the firstborn going to die. What did Pharaoh do? Brushed his teeth, put on his pajamas, and went to bed. What was he doing in bed? That's what Rashi wants to tell you. He was such a great, wicked person that he could take it out of his mind, you know? And just forget about it, right? You know, Pharaoh was a real person. He's an analogy we call the Yetzirah, the evil inclination. Everyone of us has a little Pharaoh inside of us telling us, if it feels good, do it. Don't pay attention to telling the Aaron Yeshiva. Just go, right? Just go and do it, right? But now his life is threatened. He wakes up in the middle of the night, he's going to die. He's the only firstborn that didn't die. And he runs to Goshen. What was he dressed in? His pajamas, right? The children have a song they sing here, Passover, like, Paro be pajama be emsa halayla. Pharaoh's in his pajamas and he runs to Goshen. Where's Moshe? He's frantic. He thinks he's going to die, right? And the children fool him. He's here. He's there. Finally, find Moshe. Come on out. It's Pharaoh. Pharaoh, don't you remember last time I was in your palace? You made a decree. Next time you see my face, you'll die. I can't come out. What should I do? I'm going to die. There's only one thing you can do, Pharaoh. You don't want to die? One thing you do. Go outside and make a proclamation at the top of your lungs and scream out, Jewish people, until now you are my slaves. From now on, you're Avdei Hashem, you're servants of the Almighty. And the Midrash tells us that he went out and made that proclamation, and his voice was amplified in the entire land of Egypt. They heard his voice, and that minute we became free. Right? So at that minute we were free. So the commentaries explain. The 4 questions are really 1 question. The child asks the father, you know, father, you're showing contradictory symbolism. Because what is matzah and morah symbolize? Matzah was the poor bread they ate in Egypt. And morah is the bitterness, that's slavery. What is leaning and dipping potato chips, right? What does that symbolize, right? The nobleman leaned like that on couches and they ate special foods. That's freedom. You're eating matzah, which is a symbol of slavery, and you're leaning, which is freedom. You're eating more, which is slavery, and you're dipping, make up your mind. Are you free or a slave? Which one is it? It's a contradiction. And the answer is, Avodim Ayinu, the Pharaoh Mitzrayim, we were slaves to Pharaoh in Israel that night, the night of the killing of the firstborn. The first half of the night, we were slaves. Second half of the night, we were free. That's why it was a symbolism of freedom and slavery on the same night to demonstrate the fact that half the night we were slaves, half the night we were free. Duh, beautiful, right? So now you know the answer to the 4 questions. Let's continue. We were slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt, and God took us out with a strong hand, outstretched arm. If had the Almighty One, the Holy One, blessed be, had not taken our ancestors out of Egypt, then we and our children and grandchildren would be subjugated to Pharaoh in Egypt. Doesn't mean we'd still be slaves. Maybe there would have been proclamation. He would have freed us later. He would have freed us, or maybe he would have fought us. In some way, we got now, right? But we still have that mentality. You know, there's such a thing called the slave. People who were slaves for many years, even when they're free, they have a slave mentality. They look at things much differently. The Jews were free. The Cheirus Olam, right? The slavery in Egypt is called in the Torah Kor HaBarzel. Kor HaBarzel means the iron furnace. You take gold, it has imperfections in it. What do? You put it in a very hot furnace and you smelt it down. You burn all the imperfections out, right? The slavery in Egypt burnt down all the imperfections in our character. The Jews became sensitive to other people's suffering. You know, there are people in the world that suffer, and they only care about their own suffering, right? But here, we're sensitive to suffering. Jews were always in the forefront of all civil rights, every anti-apartheid. The Jews were always in the front because we're sensitive to the others. So had God not taken us out, we would still have this subjugation to Egypt. Therefore, it's relative to us. It's not only to them. We also have to have that. It's also relative to us. And therefore, the conclusion is, even if we're all wise, we're very smart, we can figure out ourselves, or we're nivonim, we can infer one thing from another, understanding. We're elders, we're not so smart, but we went through the school of hard knocks. See people with a gray beard, right? They have experience in life. Or we know the Torah, I'm not so old, I'm not so smart, but I have a good teacher. I know the Torah, right? Page 27. it's still a mitzvah upon us to tell about the going out of Egypt. And the more you tell about it, the more praiseworthy you are. So it's a mitzvah this night to talk the most you can about the going out of Egypt. And to stress this point, we tell a story of five great rabbis, Rabbi Elazar, Rabbi Yeshua, Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah, Rabbi Akiva, Rabbi Tarfon, right? And they were leaning in, but they had to say it was after the destruction. These rabbis lived during the time of the destruction. After the destruction, there was no temple. So they were in Bnei Brak, where Rabbi Akiva lived, right? And they told the story of Egypt all night long until their students told them, our rabbis, the time has come to say the Shema of the morning, right? These five men either were Kohanim or Levim or converts. Rabbi Akiva was a convert, meaning we know we'll see later on the tribe of Levi were not slaves; they didn't have to work. So not one of them had an ancestor was a slave, right? Right? Akiva's ancestors were not Jewish; they were Kohanim, right? And in spite of that, they told the story all night long, and the students telling them the time has come. Shabbat. See, we're going to get to the next paragraph. We have a mitzvah to remember the going out of Egypt every single day of our lives, right? Moshe, when do we fulfill that mitzvah? You know when? And Shema, which part? The last verse of the Shema. I am Hashem who took you out of Egypt, right? Have in mind, I'm remembering the going out of Egypt, right? So that we have to do every single day. On Pesach, we tell the story. It's like, you know, when you want to put a telephone number into your telephone or into your watch, you have to push a lot of buttons to get the phone in, the number in. Then you just push the memory and it automatically remembers, right? On Pesach, we put the number in. We talk about the going out of Egypt, all the details. And then we say the Shema, you just push the button. So they told him, even though you have to stop talking about the going out of Egypt, you still have the mitzvah of Shema where you can remember the going out of Egypt. It's still connected. So Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah says, I'm like 70 years old and I didn't merit they should say the Shema in the evening, the going out of Egypt, until Ben Zoma came along and said, so what's going on over here? The Talmud says that Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah was a young man, he was only 18 years old, and they deposed the leader of the court, Rabbi Gamaliel, and they chose him to be the next leader. So he said, I got to ask my wife. His wife says, you know, I'm sure they're going to bring Rabbi Gamaliel back, it's only temporary, he says, which she was right. But he said, in spite of that, I still want it, it's still a very great honor. But you're only 18 years old, you have a black beard, all those guys have gray beards, I'm not going to respect you. He said, you're right, okay, I'll tell him no tomorrow. Goes to sleep, wakes up in the morning, his beard is gray. All right? I look like I'm 70. Ben Shiva, I'm like 70, right? What's the gematria of Ben? Bez is 2, Nun is 50, 52, and he was 18. Add Ben to his age, 18 to 52 is 70, I'm like 70, right? And in spite of this miracle that happened to me, the rabbis had an opinion that when you say the Shema at Ma'ariv in evening, you don't say the last paragraph. Why? Because what's the last paragraph talk about?
Egypt.
What does the last paragraph talk about? Besides Egypt, what else does it talk about? Tzitzis. And tzitzis is only during the daytime. At night, there's no mitzvah tzitzis. You know, if you put tzitzis, you don't make a bracha at night. You can take it off at night, right? And it says, remember the going out of Egypt all the days of your life seem to apply during the daytime. So in Ma'ariv, you don't have to wear tzitzis. And you don't have to say the going out of Egypt, so leave out the last paragraph. And Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah disagreed, but he couldn't bring a proof until a young man named Ben Zoma came along and he said, you know what? It says, remember the going out of Egypt, call Yemechiecha all the days. There's an extra word over there. You don't have to say, if we just say the days of your life, we mean daytime. All the days means evening and night. And how do rabbis interpret that verse? Call Yemechiecha lahavi the most of Mashiach. Even when Mashiach comes, there's a verse that says that the miracles of Mashiach are going to overshadow the miracles of the going out of Egypt. You will no longer say, blessed is God who took us out of Egypt, but God who took us from the four corners of the earth, and he brought it. There are going to be so many miracles when Mashiach comes. So I might think when Mashiach comes, don't you have to mention, remember the going out of Egypt anymore. Therefore, it says, call Yemechiecha, even when Mashiach comes, we still have to remember the going out of Egypt. And if you read it homiletically, what does the last line say? Kol Yemechiecha lavi limot haMashiach. Literally, all the days of your life to bring the Mashiach. We want Mashiach now. We got to bring the Mashiach every day. What's the best way to bring Mashiach? Reach out to other Jews. Okay, so until now we talked about theoretically, right? And how it's a mitzvah for us because we also are affected by it. Now we want to go to the Torah and see what the Torah says. We started with the blessing of the Torah, Baruch Hamokom, Baruch Hu, right? The Torah mentions four different places it talks about telling your children, and each place it says it differently, right? A wise son, a wicked son, a simple son, and the one who doesn't know how to ask, right? So if you look in the Chumash, I'll tell you outside, look in the Chumash, if you look in the book of Exodus, chapter 12, verse 26, it says, your son will say to you, what is the service to you? And you shall say, it's a Passover sacrifice to Hashem. Chapter 13, verse 8, it says, tell your son on that day, right? Because it's got to be when I went out of Egypt. Chapter 13, verse 14, it says, your son will ask you tomorrow, what is this? And you tell him, God took us out of Egypt, right? And in the book of Deuteronomy, three books later, chapter 6, verse 20, it says, your son will ask you tomorrow, what is the testimony and the laws and the justices that the Lord our God commanded you? Right? So it says it in four places, and it says it differently in every place. From here you learn that you have to teach your children. You know, you can't just have one standard way to teach everybody. You have to know where your child is coming from, or your students, right? Everyone's different. You have to talk to them differently. There are four different kinds of sons, and each one I talk to differently, right? So the Haggadah explains. The wise son, what does he say? What are the statutes and the justices? The Eidus means the testimonies. It's a mitzvah to have historical evidence, historical significance, like she has the matzah and the morer, the giran osher, the sinew, that the wrestling mat, which ate Jacob, right? What else? The chukim, was, we don't know the reason, right? Meat and milk, wool and linen, red heifer. And the mishpatim, don't murder, don't steal. He wants all the categories that the Lord, our God, commanded you. So he says you, he's not excluding himself, he's our God. But you are the generation that heard it from God. I'm the next generation. What did he tell you? He wants to know it all. I once had someone came to me. I went to Hebrew school 5 years. I know nothing about Judaism. This guy wanted to learn the entire Torah in one night. Unfortunately, he wanted to sleep that night too. Right? He can't have everything. Right. But you know, someone who's thirsty for knowledge, it's a pleasure to teach them. So you tell them everything, the laws of Passover, until the last law is, don't eat after the Afikoman. Why? Keep the taste in your mouth, right? The wicked son, what does he say? What is his service to you? Right? To you and not to him. Because he excluded himself, right? He's denying God, right? I mean, how do you know it's a wicked son? He doesn't ask a question. He says, what is it to you, right? I don't need it, right? What is it to you, right? So he excludes himself, so you knock out his teeth, make his teeth stand on edge. We don't let him eat sacrifice, you know? It's roasted, it's barbecue. Can I have some? No, you can't have any. And we say, because of this God did to me when I went out of Egypt, me and not him. So this verse it says by the son who doesn't know how to ask, right? Me and not him. You don't even talk to him, Dre. You don't say, I don't even talk to me and not him. Had he been there, he would not have been revealed, because they're the Jews that didn't want to leave Egypt, right? They didn't want to leave Egypt, right? Why bother going to Israel? Build the temple in Borough Park, right? Why bother going, right? And they died during the plague of darkness. The Egyptians through the sea. Had he been there, he would have died, right? No, there was a great rabbi of Chaim Voloshin. And there was a boy in his yeshiva that went off the path and became a Christian. And the story goes, years later, he bumped into his rabbi in a train station. He saw him with his crest around his neck. He said, I'm sure you have many questions on Judaism. Yes, rabbi, I have many questions. But I want to ask you one question first. What was the order of events? First, you went off the path, and then you had the questions. First, you had the questions, then you went off the path. First, I went off the path, then I had the questions. In that case, I can't answer your questions. Because your questions aren't questions. Your questions are answers. On a question, there can be an answer. On an answer, I know your questions are just rationalization, right? You don't want to do this, so you have a question, right? And I ask you a question. Have another question. Why don't they go to the army? Why do they throw rocks at Mayor Sharon? You're right. They should go to the army. You're right. But why does that have to do with you keeping Shabbos, right? I want to have a question. Yes, I have another question. I want the question's not a question. The question's an answer. You can ask any question you want as long as you really want to know an answer. You want to know an answer, I'll answer your question. But if you just want to ask a question, then there's no answer to a question. There's no answer to an answer. Your son will say to you, he's not asking you, right? What do you need it for, right? What do you need all this trouble for Pesach, cleaning the house, all this trouble? What do you need it for, right? That's the wicked son, right? His fourth son, the Babich Rebbe said, today's the fifth son. You know, he doesn't even come to the Seder. The simple son, what does he say? What's this? What's going on, right? And answer him a simple answer. With a strong hand, God took us out of Egypt from the house of slavery. You know, someone asks you a simple question, give him a simple answer, right? Don't give him a complex answer. You lose him. You understand what you're talking about? You have to know how to talk to each one. And the one who doesn't know how to ask, at Pesach lo, at is a feminine, the mother, the little child, or in a gentle way, in a feminine way. He doesn't have to be a little child. The one who doesn't have to ask, he can be a college professor. He just doesn't know how to ask. He thinks he knows everything. He doesn't know how to ask, right? He knows it all, right? As it says, you should tell your son on that day, saying, there's no question here, because of this God to me when I went out of Egypt. Right? The one who does that. Now, the order of the Torah is different. The order of the Torah, which first is the wicked son, then is the son who doesn't know what to ask, then is the simple son, and then three books later is the one of the wise son. And the old Kitav says, why does the Torah change? Why does the Haggadah change the order? Because, you know, the Jews are going out of Egypt. They see all these miracles. And Moshe reveals to them that a day is going to come when you have a wicked son. And he's going to say, who needs it all, right? And then you have a son who doesn't know how to ask. And if you don't reach out to him, you know who's going to reach out to him? The wicked son, right? After the fall of the Soviet Union, if we don't go and be part of Russian Jews, the Jews who Jay, they'll get them. The reform movement will get them, right? We got to get them first, right? And then even the simple people, they can ask questions. You know, throughout our history, the groups that went away from Torah were the intelligentsia, the intellectual ones. The simple Jews always kept the Torah, right? And they're going to ask, what's going on? This guy says this, this guy, how do I know what to listen to, right? And three books later, the Torah reveals, we're about to enter the land of Israel. There's going to be a day when even the wise son will start asking questions. Maybe he can be a little bit more lenient. Yeah, everybody's so strict over here, so strict over there, right? Says, I got to first take the wise son and strengthen him, teach him Torah. Then you go to the wicked son, not going to see, show me what he's talking about. Then you go to the simple son, and finally you go to the son who doesn't know how to ask. And what is our goal with the son who doesn't know how to ask? Get him to ask. Get into ask. The key to outreach is not lecturing and not teaching. It's getting them to be bothered by the question. You take a secular Jew and say, are you proud of being Jewish? Why? Right? Is there a God or isn't there a God? Does it make a difference? Is Torah true or not? He doesn't have to give you an answer. He just has to be bothered by the question. If he's bothered by the question, he'll look for the answers, right? You can suggest, come to our yeshiva, we have some answers, right? But the main thing is not the answer, the question. If he's bothered by the question, get him to ask the question, and then he'll look for the answers, right? Now, for which four of these sons, I just want to say analogy, they say analogy, the four sons are four generations of Jews in America. The grandfather is the wise son. He came from Europe. He makes the Passover Seder with the wine and the matzah, the whole works. Second generation, wicked, I say wicked with quotation marks. So the generation that, for whatever reason, stopped keeping Torah. But as long as his father's alive, he comes to the Seder. His father dies, no Seder. Third generation, what's this? Zadie had a Seder, you don't have a Seder, right? Fourth generation, never even saw a Seder. Doesn't even know what they're going to ask, right? There's four generations. Zadie, they don't even come to the Seder, right? So from which one of these four sons do we see a proof from the Torah that's a requirement to talk about the going on of Egypt this night? The first three sons asked questions. They said statements, right? You got to answer it. Say it's not Passover. Say it's Shavuos. Say it's Hanukkah. Your son asks you a question. You got to answer him, right? The proof is from the last son, right? He's sitting there minding his own business. The Torah says, you got to go over to him and tell him. God, tell him. From the fourth son, we have a proof. And this night, there's a mitzvah to tell about the going out of Egypt. Now, when is this mitzvah? Next paragraph. What's the next paragraph say? I might think Rosh Chodesh Nissan. That's when you start. It says, on that day. If it means on that day, I mean, when it's still day, Erev Pesach, when we slaughter the Passover sacrifice, maybe then tell him. It says, because of this, this is something you point to with your finger, right? I only told you this when you have the matzah tomorrow. When is the time to tell the children? When you're eating the matzah tomorrow. In other words, when they see the parents keeping the mitzvahs, when they see the example, when the parents are doing the mitzvahs, that's the time to tell them, right? And I have a deeper interpretation of that verse because of this God said to me in the morrow. Because if you look in Parshas Bo, right, and in the book of Exodus, chapter 10, verse 2, it says, right, actually starts verse 1. Come to Pharaoh, I have hardened his heart, the heart of his servants, in order to put my wonders in his midst. In order you should tell the ears of your children and grandchildren how I played around with Egypt and the wonders that I put in them, and they will know that I am God. This verse is telling us something very, very profound. We were under the impression that, you know, I was this Passover Seder. It just so happened we were Egypt, and it just so happened we were slaves, and we had God brought 10 plagues, so to commemorate that, we make a Passover Seder. True? False. God didn't have to make 10 plagues. You know, the 10 plagues lasted a whole year. Every plague was a week. 3 weeks was by a whole year, right? God could have just killed the Egyptians. We could have walked out, make one plague, keep it going, right? Why are there 10 plagues? So we have a nice, juicy story to tell our children. That's what it says in the verse. I'm putting these wonders in his midst. Why? You should tell in the ears of your children or grandchildren what I did to Egypt. So it's not because there were 10 plagues that we have a Passover Seder. Because if God wanted us to take a Passover Seder and tell our children, that's why I made 10 plagues. That's what it says in the verse we just read. Because of this, God took me out of Egypt. You know what this means when you have the matzah and maror in front of you? Because of the matzah and maror. Because he wants us to make a Passover Seder and eat matzah and maror and tell our children the story. That's why I made the miracles in Egypt. Okay, now we continue the actual story. Mitchilo of the Avodah Zarah. So the Talmud says that the Haggadah starts off with derogatory statement about the Jews and then it ends up with praise. What's the derogatory statement? The two opinions. One is we were slaves and God made us free. That's on a physical level. And some say it's this verse we're about to read now, which is on a spiritual level. And the Rambam brings both. We have to say both. Originally, our ancestors were idolaters, right? And now God brought us close to his service. As it says, and God said, we're quoting a verse from Joshua. Joshua said to the people, so said the God of Israel, on the other side of the Jordan, of the river, did your ancestors live from days of old? Terach, the father of Avraham, the father of Nachor. You know, Terach was an idolater, had a store that sold idols, right? I asked him, how's business? He said, thank God, right? Thank God, right? And you know, the story, Avram broke down all his idols, right? And the father of Nochar, and they worshipped other gods. And I took your father Abraham from the other side of the river, and I took him to the land of Canaan, and I increased his children, and I gave him Isaac, and I gave Isaac Jacob and Esau, and I gave Esau the land of Seir, and Jacob and his sons went down to Egypt. This one verse spans Jewish history from the time of Avram till Jacob goes down to Egypt, right? See, the Haggadah wants to make it short. So what does it mean, originally we were idolaters? Originally we were idolaters, right? Terach. And now, now means Avram. That's already 3,000 years. Why is it now? It's not now. It's 3,000 years ago, right? Why now? And my Rebbe Revolver said it means now, right now, the night of the Seder. Now God brings us close. On this night of the Pesach, God brings us close to him, right? So the story goes about this. Had a member of parliament in Moravia was an Orthodox Jew, and he was on a train. And a free thinker, a young free thinker, heard that there's a member of parliament who wants to meet him. He sees him going to keep us studying Talmud. What? You're an old-fashioned Orthodox Jew? Young man, I'm not old-fashioned. You're old-fashioned, right? Originally, we were idolaters. Esau was the old school. Avram's the modern. I'm modern. I'm Avram. You're Esau. You're Terach. You're Terach. You're the old school, right? Idolatry is good old hedonism, right? There's no new morality. It's the same old one, right? And I'm modern. Okay. Okay, blessed he who kept his promise to Israel. Hashem, Chishev is okay. What kind of God will keep his promise? He figured out the end. To do as he said to Avram, as it says in the Prophet Covenant, as it says, he said to Avram, surely know your children will be strangers in the land which is not theirs, and they'll make them slaves, and they'll make them pain 400 years, and the nation that they reserve, I will judge, and they'll go out with great wealth, right? This was what's called to Avram at the covenant that he made with God, right? So 400 years is 400 years. We only need you 210 years, right? So Kishev is a Kates. Kates is Gematria Kufzadik, 190, right? He subtracted 190 from 400, get 210, right? Because God told Pharaoh he could make them slaves, normal slavery, right? But Pharaoh went over and above the call of duty. He made backbreaking torture. The quality made up for the quantity, right? 200 years of backbreaking torture equals 400 years of normal slavery, right? That's why we eat the matzah in the morah, by the korach. Why? Why matzah symbolizes we went out in a rush before the dough had a chance to rise. Morah is the bitterness. You know why the matzah? Because of the morah, right? That's why we eat it together. The reason we ate it so fast is because of the morah, right? Another answer is, it doesn't say Egypt in the verse, your children will be strangers in the land which is not theirs. Avram already was a stranger in the land which is not his. The land of Israel was promised to him, but not given to him. When his wife died, he had to pay an extortion amount of money for her grave. Couldn't say it's my land, right? So when does your children, when does he have children? If you make a calculation, Isaac was 60 years old when Jacob was born, and Jacob was 130 when he went down to Egypt. So from the birth of Isaac till going into Egypt, 130 and 60 makes 190, right? And how many years were in Egypt? 210 equals 400. Altogether, there'll be 400. And Rabbi Hirsch points out there are three levels over here. First, you're a stranger. You're an alien in a foreign country. I didn't say foreign planet. Foreign country, right? And you don't know the customs, and you don't know the language, and they discriminate against you, but you're not a slave. Second stage, you're a slave. You got to work for them, but give me a slave and have humane conditions. The third stage is pain, right? Torture, right? So that's how I first started off. They were strangers, then they were slaves, and then they were torture. Now we cover up the matzah, and we're going to pick up the cup of wine. It's a teaser. We're not going to eat it. We're not going to drink it. We just pick it up, right? Then so whenever we pick up the wine, we cover up the matzah, because mostly comes before Rebbe Goffin. And that that stood for our ancestors and us, not one alone wanted to destroy us, but every generation they wanted to destroy us. And the Holy One, blessed be, saves us from their hands, right? Either it means the promise God made to Avram, or it means the Torah, right? Every generation they wanted to destroy us. Yaakov Emden wrote 200 years ago, by my soul, right? He swears the greatest miracle in history is the continued existence of the Jews. He said that 200 years ago, before the Holocaust, what do you say today, right? They always want to destroy us, and God saves us from their hands. And then now we say, go out and learn what a loved one, the Aramite, wanted to do my father. How does loved one come into the Haggadah? I mean, the Haggadah is the book of Exodus, right? Love is embracious. What's he doing in Haggadah, right? And the answer is Devarim, the book of Devarim, right? We're about to tell the story of the going out of Egypt. So we could take a book, a Chumash Shemos, and just read through the whole book, right? But that would take a lot of time. We want to get the Afikoman early, right? So there's one verse in the book of Deuteronomy, in Devarim, Parshas Kisavo, when we bring the first fruits of the, you know, you see your first fruits, your first olive, your first grape, you want to eat it, right? You have to put a red thread around it and take it to Jerusalem and present it to the Kohen. And you got to say, make a proclamation to the Kohen. So here the Torah gives us a proclamation. In this one paragraph, it sums up the entire story of the going out of Egypt. one paragraph. So the Haggadah is going to take this whole paragraph and elaborate on every verse. Let me just read it to you very quickly. You should bring the first fruits of the Kohen, right? And go to the place God chosen to you and say to the Kohen, this is what you say. Say, I have said today before the Lord your God, I have come to the land which the God swore to our ancestors to give us. Notice the change in tense. I have come to the land that God swore to our ancestors to give us, from singular to plural. And he presents them with the fruits, right? And he puts them before God, and you say, and you say before the God, an Aramite wanted to kill my father. Again, it's singular. And he went down to Egypt, and he sojourned there few in number, and he became a great and awesome nation. And the Egyptians did bad to us, and they called over, it's plural, and they caused us pain, and they put upon us harsh labor, and we cried to Hashem, the God of our fathers, and God heard our voice, and he saw our pain and our affliction, right, and our pressure. And God took us out of Egypt with strong and outstretched arm, with great wisdom in war, and he brought us to this place, and he gave us this land, and now I have brought the first of the fruits, the land which you have given me, Hashem. Notice, singular, plural, back to singular. And the idea behind that is that every individual has to feel, I'm a chain in the link. I'm part of Jewish history. Whatever happened to the Jewish people happened to me. So it starts off with singular, plural, singular, right? And it starts off with Lavan. That's why the Haggadah starts with Lavan, right? Lavan wanted to kill my father. And when that, because Lavan, Pharaoh only destroyed, we're giving Pharaoh a compliment over here. Pharaoh just wanted to kill the men, the boys. And Lavan wanted to kill everything. As it says, Lavan wanted to destroy my entire, he ran after Jacob and he wanted to kill him, right? What's the connection between Lavan and going down to Egypt? It's a beautiful explanation, right? Well, first of all, when there was a famine in the land, Jacob had a choice. He could send his sons down to Egypt, which was a physical danger, or back to Lavan. Lavan had food, right? But that was a spiritual danger. Lavan wanted to destroy the Jews spiritually, right? Now, the old Kitav has a beautiful explanation out there. When Avram Avinu, the world was very upset. He's teaching the world about one God. They didn't like that. But he doesn't have any children. He's 99 years old, no children, no problem. He'll die, that'll be the end of it. At 100, he has a son. Oh, no, one son, right? But that son, right? He also, you know, they were going to sacrifice him. That would be good, right? Right? Then he survives. But he only has two sons. And one of them is Esav. He's one of ours. No problem, right? Right? And Yaakov is an old man already. He's in his 70s. And he goes to Lavan. He's one of ours, right? Right? And he marries Lavan. So no problem. Lavan will take care of him. And under the nose of Lavan, he has 12 tribes. All of a sudden, where'd they come from? Oh, the Jewish people. They're here. Right? And Lavan goes, what are you doing? He wants to kill them all, right? And God doesn't allow him to kill us all, right? What's the connection between Lavan and going down to Egypt? That was many years later. Why did Jacob go down to Egypt? Because Joseph was down there, right? How did Joseph get down there? The brothers sold him, right? Why did the brothers sell him? Because they were jealous. Why were they jealous? Because he was the youngest. And the father shows favoritism. And how do you be the firstborn? Everybody understands you show favoritism to the firstborn, right? He was the youngest, right? Right? Why was he the youngest? Because who did Jacob marry first? Leah before Rachel. Had he married Rachel first, then Joseph would have been the firstborn. Then they wouldn't have been jealous, right? Why did he marry Leah first? Lavan. It was all Lavan's fault. Because he switched them and he married Leah first. That's why Joseph was the youngest. That's why they were jealous. That's why they went down to Egypt. Okay. Okay, so we don't have time to go through all the things. We just go through a few things. Here we go through every verse over here explains it, right? Right? They didn't go down to settle, only temporarily in a few of numbers, right? The rabbi said they had 76 children at one time. Poru, they were fruitful, Yishrutu, they swarmed, Yerbu, they increased many, six, and they were all healthy. And the land was filled. So the Jews were mitzvah on him. They kept their Jewish dress. They wore their bearded payas, and they kept their Jewish language. They spoke Hebrew, not Egyptian. And they kept their Jewish names, Moshe, not Maurice, right? Shlomo, not Stephen, right? But in spite of the fact that they were unique, they started assimilating. And the Egyptians, the land was full. Wherever they saw the Jews in the theater, and the movies, and the circus, there were Jews everywhere. And the Jews just started assimilating, right? And what's the antidote to assimilation? What's it called? Anti-Semitism. You forget you're a Jew, they remind you you're a dirty Jew. I saw a picture of Jews going into the gas chambers. It said underneath it, the only good Jew is a clean Jew, meaning a dead Jew, right? Right? So right after that, we have a new king. Question, please.
I thought they were
in the 49th level. Yeah, but they were. But they kept their dress and their names and their language.
They were in the
49th
level.
Yeah, they sinned. They worshipped idols, right? But they still kept their identity, right? Mitsuyanim, right? And it says, Haaretz, the land was full of them. Tomole or so, some means they started assimilating. And the antidote to that is anti-Semitism, right? A new king came on Egypt, right? And he made decrees against them, right? and they did bad to us. They said, outsmart them, right? They said, yeah, how we outsmart them? You know, their God has his hands tied behind his back. He always punishes measure for measure. If we drown him in the river, he can't punish us because he made an oath. He's not going to make another flood, right? But the mistake was, he's not going to make a flood of the entire world, but local tsunamis happen, right? Right? I always say, the reason why our peace treaty with Egypt has held out for such a long time, you know why? The Egyptians know all the Israelis have to do one bomb on the Aswan Dam, and Egypt's underwater, right? They don't know that, all right. By the way, what was the final downfall? What was the downfall of Egypt? The Red Sea? Water, right? Okay. And finally, it says, the lachatz, the pressure they put upon us, right? The pressure they put upon us. What does it mean, the pressure, right? If you've got to do a job, even if it's a hard job, but you can pace yourself, work for half an hour, rest for 10 minutes, work for half an hour, and so it's not so bad. Someone standing over your head with a whip, every time you stop for a second, whap, whap, it's much harder, right? Or else it means the living conditions, right? They came to Goshen, they gave them big villas, and then they had to have 6 kids at one time. There's no room, they wouldn't let them have 20 kids in one room, right? And lachas, pressure, right? You know, the chassid had 10 children in one room, and he comes to the rabbi, what should you do? He says, bring the cow in, bring the cow in. Oh no, now what do I do? Take the cow out. Ah, so much room. All right. And he took us out of Egypt, right, with a strong hand, right? And here it says, I've got to pass one thing, right? They cried to Hashem, right? It says, the many days went by, and the king of Egypt died, and the Jews cried to Hashem. Why did they cry when the king of Egypt died? They should have cried, they should have laughed, they should have, well, why would they cry when Pharaoh dies? So one answer is, right, they didn't let him cry when they worked. He had to do slave labor with a smile. Anyone who cried got beaten up. But that day, everybody was crying. They were also crying. They were crying to Hashem, not for Pharaoh. Another reason is they thought this Pharaoh would change his mind and make them free. Once he died, they were going to be slaves forever. And the third reason, the rabbis say, he didn't really die. He got leprosy, which is the skin dies. And the doctor said, to cure his leprosy, take a nice warm bath twice a day in the blood of Jewish babies. 150 babies in the morning, 100 babies in the evening. That's why they cried. Okay. And the cry came to Hashem, and Hashem heard their voice. Took us out of Egypt, right? And then we come to the strong hand, outstretched arm. I can't go through all the detail now. In the next 2 weeks, I'll go into the Haggadah more in detail, right? But finally, it says, Gilu Shechina, God's presence came down in Egypt, right? The killing of the firstborn was not really a plague, says the Maharal Prag. Shem brought his presence down in Egypt on a very high level, and the firstborn on a higher spiritual level, they died from an overdose. They couldn't take it, right? The miracle was that the Jewish firstborn, they should also die. They didn't die. That was a miracle. That's why the firstborn, we fast every Pesach, right? It's custom to make a seam. It's very hard to fast every Pesach, right? And the firstborn would do the service in the temple, and then later on, by the golden calf, they sinned, and they didn't sin. The Levites replaced them. That's why we have a Pityan Aben. We have to redeem our firstborn with the Kohen. All right. Then we come to Mofsim is the blood. Dam, there's a verse in Chronicles, it says, in Yoel, Dam v'esh v'timar sasha. In the end of time, there's going to be blood and fire and a smoke in the form of a palm tree, tamras, right? Similar to a mushroom. Was a mushroom smoked? Nuclear bomb, maybe that's what it's referring to, who knows? Right. And then we say, Yod Chazok is two, and Zerah Netuya is two, and Moreh Gadol is two, and Oz is two, and Mofsim is two, 10 plagues that God brought in Egypt, right? And we say the 10 plagues, and we take a drop of wine out of our cup, because our cup of wine is not full, our joy is not full when our enemies have to die. All of the nations, when their enemies suffer, they're happy. We feel bad that our enemies have to suffer, right? And this guy was a very, very big miser. He didn't want to lose 10 drops of wine. That's a lot of money, right? So what did he do? He put his wife's cup next to his cup. He took things to her cup. She took it to his cup. Okay. Can't lose 10 drops of wine. All right. So the Yehuda said, we have Dam Svadeh Akinim, I'll say in English, the blood, frogs, lice, wild animal plague, cattle plague, boils, hail, locust, darkness, and the killing of the firstborn. And Yehuda said, abbreviations, Atzach, Adash, Ba'adchav, these are the abbreviations. So Yehuda is basically saying is that there are three categories, right? The three categories, the first three were on the ground level, the three were above ground level, and then for the heaven, three were done by Aaron, three were done by Moshe, three were done by Hashem, right? Let's just see what the measure for measure of each one was. So the blood, what was the measure for measure of the blood? You could say that they killed the Jewish babies in the river. That's the blood. But another interpretation is very simple. When the Jews were building pyramids in the sweltering hot Egyptian sun, what did they give them to drink? What did he give slaves to drink? Mineral water, Coca-Cola, Pepsi? What do you say? What did he give slaves to drink? Nothing! You don't get a place to drink! Thirsty! So now the Egyptians for a week had to experience thirst, right? Right? If a Jew went to the Nile, took water, beautiful, drink sparkling water. The Egyptians, give me that glass, pass it out, pause it, blood. Pour it again, let's drink together. The Jew and the Egyptian drink the same cup at the same time, and the Jew drinks water, and the Egyptian drinks blood. Because everybody lives in their own world. This is my world, this is your world, same sun and moon, right? In the world of the Jew, it's water, in the world of the Egyptian, it's blood. Sfarks, right? How many hours do you think they allowed the Jewish slaves to sleep? They got up at 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, what do you think? At sunrise, right? They're going to sleep. When the frogs came croaking, the Egyptians didn't sleep very much, right? Lice. How often did the Jewish slaves get to take a bath, right? Every night, bubble bath, what do you think, right? The Jews from the concentration camps couldn't bathe, they're full of lice. They're also full of lice, right? Then there's Orov, there's wild animals, right? They used to make them watch their wild animals, they hunt wild animals, they will kill wild animals, right? Therefore, they made them take care of their animals, the animals all died with the cattle plague. Shchin, right? Boils, they beat them up, so they also covered with boils, right? Hail, they would throw rocks at them, they got rocks around throwing at them. Arba, the locusts, right? They made them take care of their fields, no fields, right? No cattle, no fields, right? Darkness, they would lock them in the dungeon and chain them to the wall, now they had to experience darkness. And finally, killing of the firstborn, that was the measure for measure that Moshe warns Pharaoh right in the beginning. My firstborn Israel. A firstborn is like in between the children and the parents, right? They're still a child, but they connect to the parents more. So the younger children, he's in between. So all mankind are God's children, but the Jewish people are the firstborn. We have a special, if a guy wants to connect to God, through the Jewish people, right? So I'll kill your firstborn. What else? The first two were with warning. The third was without warning, for not killing the first two, right? The first one in the series, he would warn him at the river. So Pharaoh made himself out to be a god, then go to the bathroom, sat in the front throne all day, but no toilet, right? So Pharaoh, at 3 o'clock in the morning, unknown to anyone else, he would take a little swim in the Nile. Nobody knew about this, right? And God says to Moshe, you stand there on the spot where Pharaoh is, right? Pharaoh comes out, nobody's around, runs to the Nile, tells him, I got a message from God, right? My son pointed out an interesting thing. You know, Moshe was a stutterer. He didn't speak well. So Aaron went with him to be a spokesman. When he came to the palace of Pharaoh, Aaron spoke. When he came to Pharaoh in the river, right, Aaron wasn't there. It was just Moshe. I have a message from, come on already, imagine how he's got to go to the bathroom, right? Anyway, okay, then the second in the theories was, and he told him in the palace, right, in front of his servants, the third one without warning as a punishment. The first two were inconveniences. Okay, I'm thirsty, no blood, frogs, I can't sleep, but it wasn't physical pain. Lice, they bite, that's physical pain. Wild animals, you have to lock yourself in the house, right? Okay. Plague, the animal plague, you know, the animals die, but it's not physical plane. Boils, that's physical plane, right? Hail again, lock yourself in the house, right? Locusts eat all the crops. But darkness, that was physical plane. There's many more things over here. I'm out of time. All right. And then we come to all the, how many plagues they really had. He says, 250, right? What difference does it make, says the villain, they're gone. They had them already, right? But the answer is, the Torah says, all the plagues I gave each of them, he won't give you. The more they get, the less we get. And finally, we come to Dayenu. Dayenu. We go through the whole list. If God took us out of Egypt, right, and not judge them, it would be enough. And if he would have not killed the first one, it would have been enough. If he took us to Sinai and not gave us, it would have been enough. It would have been enough. What do you mean it would have been enough? Wouldn't have been enough if we kept Sinai and got the Torah? It means, not that it would have been enough in the sense we'd be satisfied, it would have been enough of a reason to thank you. Everyone in itself is a reason to thank you, right? If I only had a nose, I would have to thank you. If I only had an ear, then I'd be happy with a nose without an ear, right? Ear, I only have a mouth, right? If I only had eyes, right? Only one eye. Everything is a reason to thank you. How much more so, right? Allah has kama v'kama, double, triple, right? That you took us out of Egypt, and you killed their enemies, and you split the Red Sea, and you took us to, and you gave us the manna, and you gave us the Shabbat, you brought the Mount Sinai, you gave us the Torah, you brought us the land of Israel, and you built the temple for us. So every detail we have to thank Hashem. And every individual in his lifetime has to thank God for every detail. Rabbi Gamliel says, whoever doesn't say these three things on Passover does not fulfill his obligation. One of them, Pesach, Matzah, Umorah, right? What do you mean you don't fulfill your obligation? I put on tefillin, I don't explain the reason. Do I fulfill my obligation? I put on tzitzit, right? I ate the Pesach, I ate the matzah, I ate the marah. Why don't I feel my obligation? What do you mean? If I don't explain the reason, I ate the Pesach and matzah, why should I feel my obligation? And the answer is, of course you feel your obligation of eating Pesach, matzah, and marah. It means you don't fulfill your obligation of telling the story of going out of Egypt. If you didn't tell the reason for these three things, then you're not fulfilling your obligation of telling the story. What are these three things? The Pesach that we eat, that our ancestors, we don't eat it. There's a shank bone on the table, just remind us that we don't eat it, right? That our ancestors, they, what's the reason? Because when they left Egypt, God passed over their houses, right? And it says, sacrifice to Hashem, we'll pass over, and our house did he save, right? Second matzah, we pick up the matzah. Why the matzah? Because their dough didn't have a chance to rise. In the morning after the seder, after the killing of the firstborn, the Jews put their dough in the oven. They want to make bread. They didn't have to eat matzah the whole week, just at night. And they just, take it out, and it didn't leaven. They had kept on the shoulders. They baked out on the shoulders 18 minutes, and it didn't leaven, right? Before the Holy One, they were thrown out of Egypt. They couldn't wait. And they didn't take provisions. If they would have given them a chance, they might have, I want to stay in Egypt. No, out. They threw them out. The morer, the bitterers, what's the reason? Because they embittered our lives, right? With harsh labor. Now, is this in right order? First, he passed over our houses. Then, the dough didn't have a chance to rise. And then, they embittered our lives. Which came first? Embittered our lives. Morer. Then came passed over our houses, right? And then the dough didn't have a chance. It should be morer, Pesach, matzah. Why is it Pesach, matzah, morer, right? Because the Pesach is the most important one. That's God's presence, right? And the matzah, why do we eat matzah? We went out so fast because of the morer. The morer is the reason for the matzah because we went out so fast. That's why, because we had such slavery, right? Right? But the Vilna Gaon, the Dubna Maggid gets a beautiful analogy. I got to tell this analogy. What's this analogy? There was once a man who was very rich and he had a daughter. But he couldn't find the match for his daughter. She was very old and she couldn't get married yet. He said, I'm going to find the match for my daughter. He takes her in his wagon with all his servants, right? And he travels from town to town. He's going to find the match. Finally, he finds a young man, very handsome, big Torah scholar, wonderful family, but he's poor as a church mouse. But he's rich. He didn't care. Comes to the father or the parents of the, I want your son to marry my son, my daughter. Wonderful. You know, I waited so long for this moment. I can't wait any longer. I want the wedding to take place tonight. Tonight? We don't have any food in the house. What do you have in the house? Just some hard bread? Let it be hard bread. They tied a hole. They put a piece of hard bread on every table. And that was going to be the meal for the wedding, right? Meanwhile, the father-in-law brought a beautiful set of clothing for the groom to wear. And he's getting dressed in the loose setting. The father-in-law says to his servants, when he gets dressed, take his old rags. I wanted those old rags. Okay. The groom's getting dressed. You know, every time he takes a garment off, they take it. He figure out what's going on. When the servants weren't looking, he runs to the hall, takes a piece of hard bread from the table, and puts it in the pocket of one of his old clothes. Okay. Puts on the new suit, gets married, comes to live in the city of the rich man. Finally, the day comes when they have their first spat, their first argument between the father-in-law and son-in-law. And the father-in-law anticipated that. Bring me out those rags. These were your rags. You were poor. I gave you everything. How dare you talk to me like that? You see what? I made you everything. And the son-in-law also anticipated. Give me those rags. Takes out a piece of hard bread. You wanted me to be your son-in-law so badly. Your daughter got married with hard bread, right? Because you wanted me so bad. You talk to me like that? What's the analogy? What's the analogy, right? Right? What's the analogy, right? Hashem says to us, remember the morer. Remember the bitterness, right? You were slaves. I took you out. That's why. How can you go against me, right? And we tell God, don't forget the matzah. You wanted us so badly. You took us out in such a rush. The dough didn't have a chance to rise. So really, morer came for us. But we say matzah. God says the morer. We say, don't forget the matzah, right? And I want to end with a story of this Jew who was very poor, right? But he always used to collect money in the shul and was able to survive. And he would go, you're invited for families for meals for Shabbos. The guy was able to survive. He had a friend who wasn't Jewish. He was also very poor, but he was starving to death. So his friend said, you know, I got an idea. Grow a beard and pay us, put on a kippah and tzitzis, and no one knows you're not Jewish, come with me to the shul, okay? So the non-Jew dressed up like a Jew. He collects money every day, every Shabbos he's invited for family. He's doing great, right? Comes Pesach time, this Jew says to the non-Jew, you know, next week is a holiday. You're going to have the best meal you ever tasted in your life. How do I get invited? No problem, everybody invites guests. Just sit outside the shul, go to the night, and they'll invite you. Okay. So what does this guy do? He fasts for 2 days in advance, make sure he has a good appetite, right? Right? Comes to the shul, gets invited, comes, smells the good food. What are you going to eat already? They sit him down. Glass of wine. Then a piece of potato, a little piece, don't eat too much, right? Right? Mm-hmm. Then he's got, they talk, and they talk, and they talk. You know, they're talking about for 2 hours, they're talking. Finally, they watch the ass, let's eat already. Crackers, right? Crackers, that's what they're gonna eat. I'm so hungry, you know what? The next thing they put on the table, I don't care what it is, I'm just gonna take it. They put something, horseradish, he burns his whole house with horseradish, right? Right? At that point, he goes home, right, right? Next day, he sees his friend, well, wasn't that a great meal? Well, those matzo balls delicious, 1 second. I'm so hungry, I fasted for 2 days. All they gave me was a little piece of potato, and then crackers, and I burnt my mouth. What did you do after that? I went home. You went home after the maror. If you only would have waited until after the bitter herbs, after the maror, then comes the good stuff, then comes the fish and the soup and the chicken, right? And that's how it is in life, my friends. Sometimes life can be very, very bitter, right? But just wait till after the maror, then comes the good stuff, right? In every generation, you have to see yourself as if you went out of Egypt. Tell your son that day, to me, every father says to his son, not our ancestors alone they got to take, also. And now we have the bracha, we pick up the cup of wine, right? And we start off with the halal, two paragraphs of the halal, right? We make the bracha. You redeemed us and redeemed our ancestors in Egypt. You took us from this night to eat matzah and maror. So Hashem, you take us out, holidays, right? Happy, the building of your race. Notice it says over here, you took us from... Where is it? You took us from slavery to freedom, from sadness to joy, from mourning to holiday, from darkness to great light, from subjugation to redemption. What's this referring to? So slavery to freedom was Egyptian slavery. Sadness to joy, we find that expression by the Babylonian exile, Yogon the Sibcha. Mourning to holiday, where does it say that? In the book of Esther, that was Purim, the Persian exile. Darkness to light, what's that referring to? Hanukkah, the Greek exile. And subjugation to redemption is the Roman exile that we're in today, right? Sing a new song to Hashem, right? And then we eat the matzah and the maror, right? And in the end, we come to the songs, right? Just enter the... I'll just go a little bit to the end, right? Kilo no e kilo yo e, page 82. Adir bimalucha bochor kahalacha kedudav yomrulo lecha u lecha lecha ki lecha lecha af lecha lecha Hashem amam lecha kilo no e kilo yo e adir hu yivne beisa bekarav bimera biyomenu bekarav kel b'nei beischa bekarav. We're holding by Mashiach. Build your house soon. Echad mi yodeya, echad ani yodeya, echad elokeinu shebashamayim uvaoretz. So some say he's referring to the one unique plague. Three plagues were done by Moshe, three plagues were done by Aaron, three plagues were done by Hashem directly, and one plague was done by all three. Which one? The boils. Moshe and Aaron filled their fists with soot from the oven, which was usually used as a remedy for boils, right? And Moshe threw it up in the air. Now if you want to throw something far, one hand or two hands?
One hand,
right? Someone asked me, pass the salt. I said, overhand or underhand? He said, hand to hand. All four fists of soot fit in motion in one hand. And he threw it up, right? Try it, right? And God spread all of each of it, came down as well. So all three. Echad mi yodeh, who knows the one plague? That's the boils, because it showed Hashem is one. M'shamayim of ours. The soot went up in the heaven, it came down on the earth, and it became boils, right? So we go through all the phase. And just the last one is in Aramaic again, in Aramaic. Chad gad ya, and I got you. Chad gad ya. The Zab ben Abba betray Suze. Father bought with two coins, one kid. Yosso shun rav yochlo de gad yo de zabin abba betrays uze chad gad yo. So the cat ate the kid, and the dog bit the cat, and the stick hit the dog, and the fire burnt the stick, right? And the water put out the fire, and the ox dragged the water, and the slaughterer slaughtered the ox, and the angel of death slaughtered the slaughterer, and Hashem slaughtered the angel of death. So this is in Aramaic, and it was added during the Babylonian exile. And there's many interpretations, but there's a commentary called Zera God that explains it's referring to the Passover sacrifice, right? Again, we're reminiscing last year we were in Israel, right? Because the Passover sacrifice was a lamb or a goat, right? One goat. One goat was a chagigah holiday sacrifice, and one goat is a Passover sacrifice, right? And it's teaching tuzus, that's how much cost, right? Shunra, a cat, when you see a cat in a dream, it's a sign you can have a beautiful song. They used to sing the halal when they slaughtered the sacrifice, right? The dog, when, you know, at midnight, dogs cry, we have to finish the sacrifice before it's midnight, right? And the stick, that's the exile. Or the sticker that the plagues on the Egyptians, right? The fire is the altar that burned away all our troubles. And the water is the exile that put out the fire of the altar. And the ox are the animals that they brought for sacrifices. And the angel of death, right? Just like the temple atoned for a sacrifice, atoned for our sins, so death atones for our sins. And the end, Hashem will take away the death forever, right? And he'll bring the Korban Pesach. And Mashiach will come, the Shana Abba, Yerushalayim.